go ahead and get started. And one of the things is I went ahead and Googled Birchbox. Okay? Cool. And within 1/3 of a second, actually less than 1/3 of a second, 4,460,000 options came up to learn about Birchbox. So first off, congratulations. You have built such a brand and powerfulness and pervasiveness in the industry to have that kind of response. And candidly, it's well over twice as much as your next beauty box in the industry. Ooh. So yeah, so a little bit of trivia
for
you.
I didn't even know that. That's
there
you
go.
That's so exciting.
Yep. So, so what I think we would love to hear is just from the start, how did you and Haley, I know mm-hmm. you're a partner in crime, right? How did you start to build this brand that now has this kind of presence in the industry? I think we'd all love to hear. So there you go.
So we are actually just celebrating our 6-year anniversary of Birchbox right now. So 6 years, it feels like decades of my life, beautiful decades of my life. But I always say, when people are saying, I can't believe, you know, you're still so young, I'm like, well, if you clocked my work hours, I think I've earned a lot of time. But when we started Birchbox, Haley and I were in business school. And to be really honest, we came up with the idea really from a business perspective and from a consumer perspective. And we were taken aback by what we learned after we launched. But the business insight was pretty simple. We were, you know, inspired by entrepreneurism that was coming on campus at Harvard Business School, and we were thinking about writing a business plan. And when we looked out in the world and thought about what would we write a business plan about, we noticed that with all of the conversations we were seeing around consumer trends moving online, a lot of focus on the female consumer, a lot more female entrepreneurs, nobody was talking about the biggest industry for women, which is beauty. And we just thought that was so weird. We were like, why is nobody talking about the beauty industry and disruption and the opportunity to change the paradigm for how people discover and buy beauty? And when we looked and researched a bit and talked to consumers, it became very obvious why nobody was talking about moving the beauty industry online for shopping. And it's because consumers expect to smell and touch and experience product before they buy it. And for an industry that pumps hundreds of thousands of new SKUs through it every year, that's a huge impediment to shopping online. So even in 2010, when we launched Birchbox, there was almost no shopping for beauty happening that wasn't replenishment. So people were buying maybe the thing they knew they loved. They've been buying, you know, Chanel No. 5 their whole life, so they might replenish that online, but they weren't buying new products. So that was a huge, you know, wake-up moment and aha moment for Haley and I. We thought, somebody's going to figure out how to sell people beauty products on the internet. It's inevitable. People are spending more time there. People are spending money there. The beauty industry will have to get there. Why can't we take it there? And from a consumer perspective, we were, you know, two girls who did not love beauty, but obviously used beauty, and we would often get ready together, and Haley, my very brilliant friend then and then partner, she had a ridiculously curated high-end beauty assortment in her bathroom, which I noticed because that's just not her passion. I was like, why do you have this, right? Like, you would never make the time to do this. And she would say, oh, my best friend is a beauty editor at Condé Nast. And so Molly, her best friend, would go into the closet and choose the product, teach Haley how to use it. So she didn't have tons of things, but everything she had was really nice, beautiful, on point for her. And these two insights from a business school perspective and from a consumer perspective is basically how Birchbox was born. We thought, we want to be the people, why not us, to bring the beauty industry online for retail, e-commerce for beauty. And we want it to feel like we are your beauty editor best friend. And so we didn't come out and say, we want to launch a subscription service that samples beauty. We said, how would we overcome what the internet is really bad at? And that would be trial and personalization really at that time. And we said, we want to remove all the friction. So we came up with a subscription that lets you try personalized sampling of beauty products, pair it with content, which is your best friend who teaches you why she would ever recommend it, and pair it with shopping. And in our mind, just as consumers at the time, that was the three steps. Try, learn, buy. That was the full funnel from interest to transaction. And we wanted it all to be under the same kind of roof, but, you know, proverbial roof.
So I'm curious. So I love it. Thank you. I think they could actually have you back at Harvard and teaching now, so as an extra gig. But I'm curious. So as you started that, okay, because it's also a leap of faith because you have this hypothesis, right?
Yeah.
So when did you know, when did you and Haley say, you know what, we've got this? When was like that kind of tipping point that you're like, you know, this is going to work? I mean, I'm just curious and very specific. Like, was it a person who reached out to you or was it, you know, data that you saw? I'm curious.
So it's really interesting because we got so excited about the idea when we came up with it. It was a 24-hour period where we were like, we're going to have a subscription, we're going to have content, we're going to have e-commerce. We kind of went back and forth, and we were, before we knew it, we were launching. We didn't write a business plan, actually. We said we have to test it, we're going to do this. So we were very bullish, like we just believed early on. But you know, when you asked like how did we build a brand, I'd say there was a big aha moment because we tested it first. We were in business school. We did 2 months, charged people $20 up front. We kitted all the boxes. We had 200 spots in our test. We had amazing brands, Kiehl's and NARS and Benefit, that signed up for the test to be there with us. And we were, you know, just very, again, business school students. We were like, there's an inefficient market, and brands are trying to market and acquire consumers, and consumers have this waste under their sink. Every woman knows that drawer of stuff you never use. And we are going to make the market more efficient so you could deploy your capital and, like, feel great and have higher end things. And that was really, like, our very business school minded. And the first thing that happened when Birchbox is shipped in March of 2010 to this test group was people started tweeting the most emotional reactions we could have ever imagined. And for me, I remember just like everything becoming clear in that moment because people said, where have you been all my life? I want to scream from the rooftops. This is exactly what I want. And here all the while, the beauty industry, our professors were telling us, this is really adorable, basically, but like nobody's going to buy this, right? No one's going to get it. No consumer has ever paid for a sample. And the emotional reaction to where have you been all my life quickly changed from this like very pragmatic, there's an inefficient market, how do we correct it, which is true, to we are building a brand. This is a very emotional category. This is something that really means a lot to women. And what a responsibility to build a brand. Like, what do we want that brand to stand for in 2010, in 2016? And that was a moment I remember thinking, no matter what happens, we're going to do this. And trust me, it became so hard. I mean, you might think of Birchbox as just like, oh, it was so easy. We launched, and we were very fortunate, absolutely. But there were so many times when people told us it would never work, even after we thought, like, we have all these proof points. It's obviously working.
Well, and I'm sure people still say that because that's how the world goes. So, but I'm curious. Birchbox is known as a pioneer, clearly not just in the beauty area, but in the subscription box industry.
Yeah.
And when several other beauty boxes, and of course, you know, copying is the sincerest form of flattery. We all know that, but nonetheless, I am curious, did you see them as competition or did you see them as validation of your, how did you think about, whoa, what's happening here? What'd you do?
Oh my gosh, full disclosure, we were so angry.
Oh.
Right? Initial reaction was like,
we went
through all the stages. Like at first we were like, so angry or so upset, trying to figure out like what can we do? Do we have any rights to protect things? Obviously, you do not. And then, of course, like moving out towards, well, this is really interesting. This is really flattering. Before we were a year old, a copycat had raised like 60 million euros against our idea. We had raised $1 million, wow. And yeah, there was a lot of validation. And obviously, like as things happened, I think that having that experience so quickly, it validated a few other things for us. We felt that everything was happening faster than ever in terms of speed of getting to market and speed of growth. And the company that copied us, the last company they had copied was eBay, very successfully. But it took them 10 years to copy eBay, and it took us about 6 months to copy us. And it like really was a jolt for us to say, you know what, we have to really put ourselves out there, we have to really go for this. And then when the copycat started, because it was that $60 million funded company, then it was Amazon with Allure magazine. Like, if you're going to be afraid of anybody, right, Amazon. Right after, before we were 1 year old. And I think it was just one of the best things that ever happened to us, because it gave us so much confidence that while you might be able to understand, like, at a superficial level what we were doing, that it was really hard to copy a vision. And it was really hard to understand the underlying motivation of what we were doing, and that the consumer actually can feel it.
Right.
If the consumer can feel like the reason why you exist, what's the job to be done, why does Birchbox exist? And we never started Birchbox to sell people samples. We always believed that it was way too hard to shop for beauty. There had to be a better way. People give away samples for free. Why can't we just deploy them at the right consumers and give them a much more joyful discovery experience instead of one that either doesn't happen, which we all have friends who've been using the same Clinique powder for 20 years, and or is just a ton of work. Like, you have to get your dissertation to understand the different serums that are out there and what would work for you. So, you know, we really have a different vision, and I think seeing those copycats and being afraid and then obviously being able to overcome that and still be where we are today gave us a lot of confidence that execution is really hard. Like, an idea is nothing. I always tell people who are going stealth with their idea, I'm like, why? Tell everybody. It is so hard to execute. And it gave us a lot of confidence that, you know, we really had something that we believed in, that we were gonna run at.
Okay, so you know what? So actually the execution message is a great one, because strategy and ideas, they look pretty, they feel good, but we all know the details is in the execution. So can you just walk us through one of the samples that, and perhaps it surprised you, you're like, you know what, we're going to put it in this box, and I know there's a lot more to quote than putting it in the box,
yeah.
But you decide to make, to put it in the box, and it's, and you're like, ooh, I don't know how this one's going to go or whatever, but walk us through then that path of it maybe surprised you, and then what happened in terms of that transition to the sale of the full-size product, or kind of where a path, so it's like these little mini chapters for your different products. I imagine you must almost think of them individually.
Yeah, I mean, in the early days, it was a lot easier to think like that, because the customization was just getting started. So we send out now every month hundreds of different products, and the mm-hmm. customer only sees five, right? Because we're personalizing the experience to them. But in the early days, one of the biggest risks we took when we were first personalizing was a shaded product, and personalizing something that, you know, obviously your skin tone is a really big part when you think about beauty, of getting that right. And we were also selling a pretty high-end shaded product. It was like a $45 product. So, but it was something that we thought was really special, a new product, a new brand on the market. No one had ever heard of it. And when that experience where customers were getting the right color for them, and this product is actually really special when you try it, so even though you may have never heard of the brand, it wasn't MAC, it wasn't Clinique, that became like one of the best partnerships of Birchbox's life. We built a huge business and have continued to build a huge business with that brand. And it gave us a lot of insight, another big insight for the company that was really important, because in the very early days, we were nobody. It was really hard to get any real brand to want to work with us. It was actually pretty ironic. At first they said, you're too small, come back when you have 10,000 subscribers. And a couple months in, I was like, hi. And they were like, you're too big. We don't have just 10,000 samples sitting here. I was like, great. So it was tough to get the big players on board initially, because they had 2-year lead times, and they really wanted to vet partners. So we ended up building relationships with all of these really small brands that were unknown at the time. And it was so symbiotic, those brands. And it really, all these passionate founders, these other entrepreneurs who really believed in their product and really put a lot of heart and time into building great things. And customers were getting them, and now they didn't have the same competition of $100 million of advertising spend to get you to walk up to the counter, right? We skip all of those steps. You tell us who you are, we go into your home, into your bathroom, into your most personal spaces, and now the brand and the product can stand on its own. And we built, like I said, amazing relationships, amazing businesses. And now those brands have grown up. They are sold in lots of other places. And they consider Birchbox a huge part of that story. And we feel really proud of that, too. So in the early days, I could chart all of those. Now it's almost impossible to keep track of it all.
Well, you know, you mentioned, you know, and so much of this industry is about discovery, right? And discovery in those homes or those places that matter. But what I heard from you also is there was a joy of discovering new brands before you even got to that end user. And to be able to have that opportunity to unearth that, I mean, it's like giving birth in a whole nother way. It's discovering these wonderful things that nobody knows about. So you went through discovery too.
Oh my gosh. We felt so connected to our first brand partners where, you know, to open a door, even if a merchant likes your brand, you would have to have merchandise for 50 doors, 100 doors, maybe 1,000 doors. That could put a brand out of business. And going through something with them were a very economical test. They could see, you know, who is their customer, what should we invest more in, and they could use that data to kind of decide how they were going to grow their companies. That is still very meaningful work that I think all of our merchants share. Our merchants are almost half business development, half merchants, where they're running P&Ls with the brand. They're thinking about, should you invest in a social media campaign? Should you put more dollars towards sampling? They really are a partner to try to see, you know, because it is symbiotic. If the brand is successful, we're going to get the best product. We're going to get early access. You know, we're going to get to launch things exclusively. So it definitely... It was that with me, but I think it just continues with our merchants now.
No, we heard this as well with Michael yesterday, because I know they track not only a net promoter score for their customers, but also for their partners. And I love hearing that, because again, this is what gives you length and enduring and compelling brands, is when you recognize all the stakeholders.
Right, and I think...
Not just the obvious end user.
Absolutely, and I do think that it's a different time to be a retailer, where, you know, we're coming out of a time where the retailer has all the power. You see the retailer get scale, and then they squeeze businesses, they squeeze entrepreneurs to a point where it's hard to make money. And there's a lot of industries, beauty being one of them, where there's a lot of margin to share. And that's something I always talk to my team about. Like, we want everybody to make money. The whole joy of Birchbox was always the win-win-win. That the consumer got the win of discovery that felt, you know, really seamless, cost-effective. The brand got the win of customer acquisition at a much more affordable price. And that Birchbox would win, and that no matter what kind of leverage and scale we got, we always still had to look at it that way.
Yeah. Now, that's wonderful. So speaking of looking at you, a lot of people, a lot of businesses, a lot of the press, mainstream and niche press, look at Birchbox, right? So you've been recognized in both the mainstream, according to Fast Company, which is candidly one of my favorite magazines, if you want to see what's happening and who's making it happen. They said about you, another important way that Birchbox is hedging against the possibility that consumers will experience subscription fatigue is through its business strategy. And I think starting a new company is exciting, but I think we all wonder, or should be wondering, about when other people get bored or have fatigue themselves in terms of with your brand. It's like dating sometimes, to be honest, but anyways. So I'm curious, how is Birchbox addressing fatigue, and what can we all learn from your experiences?
Yeah, so, you know, one of the things that we, I think, really held onto was in the early days, the vision was always be the best way to buy beauty. And the subscription was a great vehicle for customer acquisition to kind of skip the steps of getting to know our customer and immediately have a relationship that allowed us to talk to you about just buying beauty. And I think it's really hard when you have a product that has product market fit. I mean, we were so taken aback by the demand for Birchbox that obviously resources like went around the subscription box. But we really tried to and are very focused on balancing on the whole idea was not just to get the discovery, but was to get you to then purchase the product. So our business model is, you know, you get the revenue from the subscription, but you also, you can buy full size from Birchbox, and it's now a really significant part of our revenue. And actually, a lot of customers today come in buying something that we sell often exclusively. They come in as a full size shopper and then become a subscriber. So I think the way that we battle fatigue, it might seem really obvious, but it's by trying to have a relevant experience that isn't just delight. It is about serving a purpose in your life. So I always say we've been at the intersection of where delight meets efficacy. It's so fun to get a present, but if you actually find something new that you love and it didn't take time and a lot of money to do that, you're really excited about something now that is in your routine that you're using frequently, and you didn't have to go and do all of the work to find that. So the getting it right from a personalization perspective is a huge part of what we focus on. How can we get the algorithm tweak things even further to understand what do you want, what are you going to need, what is going to make you want to buy the full-size product? And then, of course, making the shopping experience as seamless as possible. But I will definitely admit that it's really hard when you have some part of your business that people are really attracted to bring the resources back to the full vision, and it's something we are very focused on, and it's not easy, because when people like the shiny object, you tend to like the shiny object.
Okay, so I'm going to ask a question, but then after this next question, I'm going to ask for questions from the audience. So please do have your questions ready and the microphone handy. So one of the things that I love about you, Katia, is that you use the word we a lot, and the team, and then you mentioned the algorithms, and I assume that that's not one more thing that you're doing on the back, you know. So
no,
I would love...
I do not know how to write an algorithm yet.
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 Yes.
In my free time, I will learn someday.
Between that and coding, right?
I will someday learn.
Yeah. So, but I would love you to just talk a little, and we haven't talked about that much this conference, is building a team, because you cannot do this all by yourself.
Gosh.
So I'd love to hear how you built your team, what you look for in your team, just a little bit about team.
Well, you know, first I'd say when you start a company, very few of us think about what your job is going to end up being if you're successful. Because when you start the company, you're so in the weeds of everything, and it's truly joyful to at first envision the product and the business model. You kind of get up every day for the product and business model before launch, right? You're thinking about what the user experience is going to be like, the packaging, you're thinking about your margins, you know, really passionate about the business. And then you get your first customer, your first couple hundred customers, and you are like, oh my gosh, you're so passionate about the customer, you're answering every email,
yes, exactly.
I called everybody who was happy and sad, and I still get on the phone with customers, because it's such a privilege that it almost legitimizes you. You go from being in your mind to IRL, right? You're in real life all of a sudden, and people are like, oh, you're a company, I have expectations, and everything changes, and you're really passionate about the customer. But if you're very fortunate, I consider ourselves to be fortunate, and I'm not afraid to say I do think that we've had a lot of luck. Doesn't make me feel less proud of what we've accomplished. Then it switches completely to the team. And literally my job is, how am I going to make Birchbox the most amazing place to work so that we can get the most talented people to build their careers here, and then to go out and change the world as managers and leaders of people who will hopefully inspire and change our children's expectation of what it means to go to work every day. And for me, what that means is expecting a lot from you, but also acknowledging that this is not a one-way relationship. It's two-sided. So you have a right as an employee, I tell every employee, that means like I'm gonna be more demanding of you than anyone you've ever experienced, and you have the right to be demanding of us, right? You have the right to have expectations from your employer. You have the right to think that your life, your time, your learning, your development should matter to us as much as your execution and your thinking and your strategic mind will matter. You know, that is a relationship. And it's something that I've definitely been learning and consider it to be like my life's work, is how will we build and inspire and motivate great people. In the earliest days, I'd say it's tough to know what you're doing.
What about trust? I mean, because here's your baby, right?
Yeah.
Now you, even though you love these people you've hired, you're having to give them parts and let them run with it?
And you think you're good at that, because at first it's kind of easy, because you're like, well, I'm working 22 hours a day, so like it's kind of easy to give the first few things away, because you're like, I literally can't work anymore.
Right.
And you're like, I'm so good, I learned how to delegate, I'm trusting. But I still like wake up and realize that I'm getting in people's ways.
Yeah.
And it's not because those people aren't even better than I am or very equipped to do it, but it's almost because in the early days, the way that you show your commitment to the team is that you'll roll up your sleeves, you'll do it with them, you'll do anything. Nothing is below you, nothing is above you. You will do anything to be with them and to show them that like they are a part of this with you, right? You're all doing this. And later, again, if you're fortunate enough to see the scale, that really can hold people back. That you are like still the bottleneck. You still want to approve the color of everything. You're not trusting them. And you know what it takes to trust them is for them to have the onus on them. if you're constantly there to catch every mistake and to say like, oh, but couldn't we take it a little further, then they will not learn to do that. They will expect you to do that. And yes, it feels very good, just like as a new mom, it feels very good to like comfort a baby when they need you. It doesn't teach them how to make themselves happy, how to like do things themselves. So I'd say like it is such an amazing lesson. It's a hard lesson to say, the way I used to define value at my company was to wear every single hat and to be good at everything and to know what you were doing and you were doing, and I could rattle off the stats of everything. And now the way that I'm good is to know, is communication flowing through this company right? Are people clear on what our priorities are? Do they know what the company's vision is? Do they know their part in it? Do they understand what we're sharing every week at our dashboard, how those numbers relate to the work that they're doing? And now all I think about is organization design, recruiting, you know, communication, and I do spend just so much time just trying to learn about how to define something new again, because it's the world I would like my kids to be in.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting, is passion is such a powerful aphrodisiac, and you assume that everybody else gets that. And the interesting thing is, and so, you know, I'm a few years older than you, but what you just mentioned is something I still struggle with, is how do you let other people run with it? Because when you care about your product and your brand, and you should, that is how you should always feel, you should always be very passionate about it, it is hard to let it go. And sometimes you actually have to pull yourself right out of the picture frame, because people will, they're going to come to you just because you are who you are, because you are the leader in this company, because you are the one. So anyways, I really applaud that you are working at it.
Trying.
I can tell, I can hear
I'm
it in
trying.
Your voice. Well, keep trying.
Thank
because
you.
It will also, by the way, it will free you up to be able to step back and see from a strategic sense where you need to be.
It
but
all,
you can't unless you get above.
And I think something really beautiful happens, I will say, like when you're sitting in a room and you realized you had nothing to do with one of the most brilliant, you know, ideas, campaigns, and you realize you have nothing to do with it, but you can see how you did.
Yeah.
Right? How you helped people get to that place, but it wasn't any of your idea, nothing ever came from you. And it is a magical experience when you realize that it's bigger than you. It's a humbling experience. And it makes you want to strive to continue to stay relevant to your organization in a new way.
Yep, wonderful. Okay, do we have a question or two from the audience? Okay, we're gonna start right with this gentleman up here, because you're right up here, so I couldn't miss you. And then if there's somebody else so that I know where the next question will come from, make sure you raise your hand at that point in time. Please say your name and your question.
Hi, Katia. Thank you for being here. My name is Tyler. I'm founder of Created with Love, which is a date night subscription for couples. And my question for you was, you had mentioned that, you know, in the beginning it was a very business-minded approach, focused on the industry. But then you got to see all that emotional responses. How did or did it, how did your strategy and vision change once you realized that there was such an emotional response that was, you know, compared to the industry side?
Yeah, I'd say, you know, we were thinking about the brand of Birchbox always because we knew it was going to be a consumer brand. So to the extent that, you know, what's our name, what's the logo, like, what is it going to look like? But when we had a realization of what meant to be a brand to consumers, we just took it to a whole new level. Our first hire for like a tech, you know, beauty e-commerce company was our head of editorial, like the brand voice, the person who managed all of social media, who created content for us, and who really made our product detail pages and our cards and every email we sent stand out in people's minds. They knew that was written by somebody who obsessed over every word. And that was 2010, so like the written word was actually really powerful and still, you know, much more ubiquitous than photo and video yet. But I would say that that was like our first big gesture. We had no money, we weren't paying ourselves, and we hired Molly, Haley's beauty editor, best friend, paid her, and said like, our brand is going to be everything. And then we paid small consultants to come in and map our brand. Who was our girl? What was the voice? Before we did a lot of other things that might seem really like business, like, I mean, we were a business school student, so eventually we wrote a business plan and we did all of those things. But I'd say like we did really throw ourselves into like, what does it mean? What is the responsibility around a brand that is like a human to people? People talk to us. They talk about Birchbox like the way you talk about a human. I always say it's like, so so interesting to hear people saying, I'm going steady, I'm breaking up, we're getting married. I'm like, this is real. We've had over 10 engagements in a Birchbox because it was the woman's like favorite thing that happened every month. It's so magical. So we now think about that all the time, the responsibility. This means so much. This makes people so happy. A mother at the end of the day, and like, how do we then bring that back into the branding, tell those stories, celebrate those stories, or just make that the focus? And in the early days, we didn't know what we were doing, but we would say things about our brand, and then the customers would kind of say it better, and then we would say it that way. So we would just like listen to the way the customers say, and then we'd change all our taglines and like rewrite things because they seemed to like really get it, and we let it kind of evolve and be like this thing that we were doing together. But we didn't know what we were doing. We were just trying a lot of things, and we were very present on social. And we definitely built our brand through like responding to things like customer service, and it wasn't like we all of a sudden had a commercial or beautiful photos. We were literally just like using emojis and thanking people and calling people, and that's how we built our brand.
You seem like you have a very real-time osmosis. That's what I feel like, is it's just continuous osmosis that's happening real-time. How beautiful. Did we have another question? Okay, we have one right on the aisle there, the lady, and then the next one after, we'll come back to the lady in yellow, okay? So those will be the three we'll do for right now. Thank you, Tyler, by the way. Good one. Water over there.
Hi, I'm Erin from Brick Loot. If you go back and look, what would be like the one thing that you think you would want to have done differently, or like the big mistake that you kind of think, oh, that was the worst thing and that you learned from?
So don't kill me. You said your name is Erin?
Yes.
Don't kill me, Erin. I just don't think that way. I feel so grateful for being stupid and naive and not knowing what I was looking at, like getting into. I even when people come to me as entrepreneurs, I want to save them from the mistakes, but I don't want to scare them from the mistakes, because if I knew what this would be like, I really doubt I would have done it. Not because it hasn't been amazing, but because like it is terrifying every day, and this is why I did it, mind you, to know what you're made of. Every day to like meet yourself and be like, are you gonna deal with that today? Okay, and I don't think everybody wants that. And I think if you consciously knew that that was what every day was going to be like, I don't think it's an easy choice. So I definitely don't think of, I mean, we've made epic mistakes that you think, I thought we could never come back from. And I wouldn't trade it at all, because it brought the team together, it brought our customers together. I'll tell you like one story that was really big. It was a little after we were a year old. I guess it was like our second holiday, but our first holiday was like 3 months after we launched. So our real first holiday. Our shipping provider double shipped 7,000 customers two boxes, and 7,000 people did not get boxes.
Oh.
And this we knew was happening. We knew before the boxes were landing that this was going to happen, and we, like Birchbox at that point was still pretty alone. People were obsessed with getting their boxes, and it was Christmas, okay? Like our gift to you box. It was, everybody at the company became a customer service agent. We all stayed all weekend, all night, led by our customer service team, which they're incredible, organizing all in Google Docs, calling every single customer, talking to them, of course, like writing it, so expensive. But honestly, like I truly believe those are some of our highest lifetime value customers. The ones that we had epic failure, and then came and we did that for them. And on top of that, one of every employee's, whether they're current or gone, like most vivid memory, like most happy memory, was all of us sitting around together and dealing with that together. It really brought the team together. So I don't regret it. I mean, things I would like people to never have to experience. Never like wasting your time on fundraising meetings that aren't gonna go anywhere. Like your time is a commodity. It's really important to make sure that you're spending it well. And sometimes when you can get caught up in fundraising, you can really end up spending a lot of time that you should be executing on meetings where you would be like the first ever thing they did like you, right? So like if I had any advice and you ever are out fundraising, I'd say like try to meet with people where you wouldn't be like such a random fit in their portfolio, because the likelihood of you being the first is low. So spend your time on people where they love inventory and they love the idea of manufacturing boxes every month.
Awesome, awesome. I believe you had a question. Thank you, Erin, by the way. So while the microphone's getting over there, you embody playing fearless, right? Isn't that a good way to live?
And I like that you said that. That's very nice of you.
Play fearless.
Hi, Katia. I'm Brittany with the TAW section. I have a couple of questions. My first one is, how did you come up with the name Birchbox and mm-hmm. the branding around it? And then my second one is, I read an interview that you did, I believe, where you talked about your day. So I'm always interested when with people who have families and who have children who are married, that, and I don't even know if the term work-life balance is appropriate anymore, but we'll just go with that since that is the most fitting way to describe it. Like, how do you manage all of the things that you have on your plate?
Sure. So the first question, how did we name Birchbox? Again, it was a pretty much a business school exercise. So my business partner and I were not beauty people. We didn't love beauty. We weren't not obsessed with beauty. It was, I know a lot about beauty today, but we just didn't want something that was like overly bubblegum, glamour, like pretty. So that just wasn't for us. That didn't represent what we wanted. We were just kind of, we wanted it to feel like beauty in the context of life. More of a lifestyle brand was always what we wanted. And we wanted a name that had a way to go, like that could expand. Because when we came up with the idea for Birchbox, you know, we were, before anybody else had started, we thought, like, we don't know where this is going to go. We don't know if this is going to ever have a men's product. We don't know if we're going to do more than beauty. So we wanted a name that allowed us to expand and that was gender neutral. And we liked at the top of the alphabet. Yep. It's good to be at the top of the alphabet for a variety of reasons. And so when we thought of gender neutral, kind of high-end sounding, and then we also said, well, we have a physical product that comes in the mail. Let's see if we can find something that has like a good physical representation. And literally we were like, trees? Trees can't offend anyone. Trees are gender neutral, like could be beautiful, could be graphic, could be modern, could be classic. We had no idea what our branding was gonna look like at this point. So we were like, trees. And we found birch very quickly and we loved the story of birch. I mean, it is pretty perfect. Birch trees shed their skin every season. They kind of are stunning in every season as they're blooming and as they're shedding that skin. They grow better together. So they like to hang out with lots of other birch trees, which is so adorable. And we just fell in love with the name. And then we were like, but we can't choose our first name. You know, we clearly that would be wrong. So we made a list of 50 other horrible names. And then Haley was out of town. She was like in Nepal. And I got a response to one of my cold emails. I cold emailed like the president and CEO of NARS and Kiehl's. And I got a response and they were like, cool, like they were basically like interested in learning more, like what's your company's name? And I was like, right, yeah. Need a name. So I couldn't get a hold of her, so I ended up buying the URL with, it was a poor graduate student, like a lot of money to me because it wasn't just available on GoDaddy. And I was like, I really hope Haley still behind the name, which she was. And so that's how we got the name.
Excellent. So then the second question from Brittany was, that kind of life balance in life. Just how do you manage life? And I think you were talking 22 hours.
In the earliest days, I'd say, so first I'd like to say that I think that we're so lucky, like we're lucky enough to be in a different time where the idea of work-life balance it doesn't have to be what the initial goal of it was, which is like go to a job that's a grind that you just like can't wait to leave and then go home where you get your replenishment, you know. For me, I feel so lucky that like I get to work with the most brilliant people who I'm learning so much from. My job is so challenging and rewarding and exciting. I feel very full and happy to be at work, but I started Birchbox the month after I got married to like the love of my life, and then I didn't see him for the first year. And I remember
no fatigue issue there.
Seriously, it was really fresh. The honeymoon period lasts a lot longer. And I remember like in the first year, he like surprised me for our anniversary, took me on a trip, and I was like, how, like how did I get you to like still love me after the first year he did all the laundry, all the cooking, you know, and he works, right? He started a company too. And he just said, it's so amazing to have a wife that's so happy. Like, isn't coming home and complaining about her job every day. It's like, it made him happy. And I think it just really reframed for me, you know, what I wanted that balance to be. And I say a few things. Like, one is it's not a daily thing, right? Like, I give yourself years for balance. In the very early years, of course, I didn't have, like, friends, much of a life. You know, I was, my friends and my family, like, became my work. My husband and I found ways to, like, work together. He has a production company. He, like, really changed my company's life by insisting we did video. So we found ways to have that. And then now that I have kids, I'm at a different stage, which does allow me to have, you know, I have more people working at Birchbox, so I can have a little bit more flexibility. But I'd say I knew very early on that mothers were really special people to work at the company. One of our very first couple hires were new moms. And they had flexible hours. That's like why they were attracted to working with us. And we were just so fine. Like if their kids had to come to work that day, if they had to leave at 4, if they didn't come in on a Friday. And I just remember thinking, these are the most like efficient humans ever. They don't waste anybody's time. They don't have bullshit meetings. They like really get things done. And I find as a mother, two things. It's the first time I've ever actually shut down my brain. Like, I'm addicted. They're amazing. And I actually get a brain break, which is, I think, makes me a better entrepreneur, a better leader, a better person at my job, because I actually turn off, think about something else, and then come back, which has been so great. And I think, you know, the early days of seeing moms be amazing and have flexible hours and be more efficient, and it isn't about grinding yourself, and then now experiencing it and saying, you know what, like, maybe you don't have to do everything. Maybe it is okay for you to slow down a little bit to speed up. It just taught me those lessons. But I'd say, like, be nice to yourself, because it's not like if you have one bad month where you don't see your family, or a few bad months where in my case, it isn't the end of the world, and it is, you have life to balance you, right? Like it's not, doesn't have to be every day.
Wonderful. Thank you, Brittany, great questions. Okay, so we're gonna switch to a few more questions here and then we will come back and make sure we end with some more questions from the audience as well. So I'm gonna kind of switch gears. We were just kind of talking very much, and we've talked much about the humanity of the brand, the humanity of running a business. I wanna switch gears to kind of the number side. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes when you're, you know, you start these ideas, that is not necessarily your strength. So I wanted to, and we could go a couple different directions. You choose.
Okay.
We can either start by talking about unit economics versus customer acquisition, or we can talk about how do you balance the drive for growth versus profitability. There's two curtains. Which one would you like to start with?
I'm happy to touch on both. I mean, I think growth versus profitability is an important topic right now because the market really has changed. It's typically led by the public market. So when the public retail sector isn't doing as well, it affects access to private capital valuations in the private capital market. So I'd say, you know, when we started Birchbox and for the first 5 years of Birchbox, growth was everything, and that's what the market value, that's where the premium valuations were coming from. So people were spending kind of growth at any cost, and you know, we, as long as the unit economics were strong, then you know, keep growing, grow into your marketing spend was kind of the mantra.
Now I'm just gonna hit pause for a second. Can you just share with everybody what unit economics is? Because not everybody might.
So as long as like the margin of the actual product kind of before the marketing and operating expenses of running your business, as long as that was strong, then you know you would kind of figure out scale later was initially how the market was running. As long as you had strong margins that with scale were only going to get better. That's, you know, that's the scale game. It was kind of keep growing and growing and growing and growing, and then you know, we'll look at the rest of operating expense and how it's all falling down to EBITDA and net income. And then things really changed, and the market said, nope, we have to see that there are business models. There's kind of really large, epic fallouts from that kind of game with FAB. And you know, now the market kind of shifted gears and got really smart and said, no, it's really important that the underlying business model makes sense, which doesn't just include the unit economics, the COGS around your product. It includes the entire spend and the entire P&L of the company, and so it's important for that company to be profitable, have the ability to be profitable at the very least. So I'd say where we are today, the market really wants to see scrappier, leaner, profitable businesses, or businesses that are there much sooner than just high growth at any cost businesses, because, you know, as you're learning and as you're scaling your spend or your marketing efforts over time, there's a belief that that discipline really does, you know, lead to the longevity, the sustainability of the business. And I would say that discipline is something that it gives you life forever, right? Learning how to say, you know what, we're going to be in control of our own destiny. We're not going to rely on outside capital to do that. It allows you a lot more freedom, a lot more kind of just, you can feel so much more in control of your destiny, which is really wonderful.
Yeah, I think that's important. Having worked for two startups, one of which was sold earlier this year, and the other one, which is just getting into that kind of pre-money stage and everything, those are very important decisions to think through. And money seems nice, but with money comes
a lot of things.
Yeah.
Responsibility, like a boss.
Yeah, and a lot of overlooking people. So wonderful. Okay, so I want to go ahead and switch gears a little bit in terms of FutureCast. Okay. I'm curious, what is it when you think, okay, because one of the wonderful things you've shared so much with us about actually Birchbox, but when you step back and you look at the overall subscription box industry, where do you see it going in, let's say, the next couple, 2 to 3 years, mm-hmm. and where might you like to see it going? Because those are sometimes two different things.
I'm really happy you asked that. I have been running a subscription-based company for 6 years. Yep. I'm so bullish on subscription. Really, really am. And I think it really depends on execution, of course. And I really ask all of you, like, the best thing we can do for the industry is to really execute wonderfully and give customers a wonderful user experience so that when the next, you know, idea comes out where a subscription makes sense, customers are really positive, right? They mm-hmm. think, this is a great way for me to get in front of product. But I'd also say that there's so many different kinds of subscriptions, so it feels really strange to talk about subscription as like this, you know, one concept. There's, you know, I think three different types of subscription. One is the subscription that has kind of always existed or existed for a while. It's replenishment, right? So you can put things on auto-replenish, that's a subscription. It's really great business, you've seen it, you can save money that way. Then there's subscription where the product that comes to you is product. So Wine of the Month has been doing that for decades, but you know, you buy something, it comes to you every month, and that is the product. And then there's subscription like Birchbox, where the subscription is a marketing vehicle to help you understand what you then might want to buy. But for us, the transaction that we are looking for is the full size sale. So there's different types of subscription, and what I'd say my belief is on the industry is that what I think has really happened right now, or what is happening right now for consumers, is that they are finally like winning, right? There's consumers are winning on every front. There's so many wonderful options. People are competing for them. Pricing is, you know, getting right. Quality is going up. Pricing is going down. You're seeing a lot of vertically integrated business kind of share value with consumers, and it's a wonderful time. And I think the way subscription fits into it, one important way from my perspective, is allowing for consumers to have a really high quality experience in categories that they are not necessarily passionate about. So it allows for passive consumption to happen at a much higher quality way. So the insight that we came to at Birchbox a couple of years ago is that, you know, Haley and I started the company as the consumers thinking, we buy beauty, we don't obsess about beauty, we don't want it to be so hard to have nice things. And we ended up figuring out that we have a consumer that really no one else has, that does not love beauty, that had never considered herself a beauty consumer, but through Birchbox starts to spend a lot more on beauty. She actually doubles her spend in beauty in 6 months because we really relate to her relationship with beauty, which is that it's not the end all be all, it's a part of life, and she doesn't want it to be as hard. So I think of her as, if you think about the way that every industry used to work, the 80-20 rule, every industry used to focus on the top 20% of consumption and say, these are my avid consumers, they spend many multiples of every other consumer, I'm gonna focus on the top 20. What we have inadvertently done, but are now very focused on, is we're focused on building a beauty company for the 80, for the just like normal consumer who is not obsessed, who is never gonna spend all of her time you know, researching and all of the majority of her spend in this category. We're really focused on just making that average spend, that normal transaction, a much better experience for that woman. And I think that's a huge part of what the subscription industry can do. It can allow, you have a passion category, it might be travel, it could be fashion, it could be food and cooking or family or DIY, and you're going to invest so much to be good at that. You're going to take the time, you're going to do the research, you're going to put yourself there because you love it. But now I think, you know, you can't really do that. You could never do that in every category. You had to pick like two things that you were going to be really good at a time. If you don't have to choose, if you can still have your thing, but every other thing you do is now higher quality, and you can passively consume and have a much better experience in every other category of your life, I think that is the opportunity I really see, is that passive consumption.
I guess in another way that I also look at it is, you know, people talk about the subscription or the membership economy. I actually think that they're all parts of the automation economy, because if you can automate other things in your life, it gives you the time
right.
and the freedom to spend on the things you really are deeply
things.
Passionate
right.
about. So deeply passionate. So I'm going to have an opportunity for another question from the audience. And we have a lady right here, and while the microphone gets to her, I have a fun, lighthearted question for
okay.
you. So we all know celebrity boxes are kind of one of those hot things, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you could receive a celebrity box from anyone, a
wow.
celebrity box or a famous person box, not any box that's actually out there, just receive a box from somebody.
But somebody curated for me.
Yeah,
that's
just for you, that's from them. But somebody that you don't
know. I mean,
know.
Elon Musk, because I hope it has a Tesla.
This is so crazy. Okay, so I asked Michael. Okay, so you want a big box.
No, I mean, I would just be so fascinated
yes.
by, like, what he would curate.
So here is the hilarious thing about that. I asked Michael the same question yesterday, and you want to know who he said?
Yeah.
Elon Musk.
Really?
And I said Richard Branson, just because then we could have the whole space race together.
That's so
but
funny.
That is so funny. I'm seeing a little trend here. I think there's an opportunity for an Elon Musk box.
I'm really obsessed.
Okay, yes. Yeah. So if you could introduce yourself and ask your question.
Hi, Desiree Staley with the Boodle Box for teen and tween girls. Was just really curious. I've been to New York and the retail store that you guys have. Just wondering how that's going. What are the pros and cons of moving into brick and mortar, and where you kind of see what's the next really exciting avenue for Birchbox?
Sure. So when we opened a store, a physical store, as an e-commerce company, the whole point that, you know, we overcame the need to go into a store definitely wasn't on our original roadmap, but it came right after we started looking at credit card data and seeing that we had this different consumer. That, you know, the majority of our customers at Birchbox were not buying beauty in any, you know, at any volume in any other channel. We were creating this new consumer, and then she was buying beauty. And when we saw that, we thought, wow, like, we have this opportunity to build the other beauty shopping experience. So if there's now an experience that is really geared towards the junkie, and I would call that every experience geared towards someone who loves beauty, we could build the home for the beauty normal, right? And if we want that beauty normal, that beauty majority, if we want her, we can't just be in one channel, most likely, because beauty is still a category that's 95% offline. 95%. And I've been looking at credit card data for years, showing how much I'm growing everybody else's business by training up this new customer and then sending them into their doors. And that's always been a great thing about Birchbox. I believe, like, if we grow the pie, there's more to share, right? But when we had this realization that we have this consumer, she feels very passionate, she feels very, she feels like she's with us on this journey of creating this experience, we thought, we have to see if we can have a brick and mortar store and see if it could allow us to become more of her place, like the place she shops. Our research says a woman won't buy beauty at more than 4 places. So obviously we want to be on the list, and then eventually we want to be number one. And opening a store was to see, like, could that change our relationship, our lifetime value of customers? I will tell you, the answer is 100% yes. It has been a fabulous experience, a great business. It's only one store, so it's a small part of our business today. But it has become like something customers want to take a pilgrimage to. They come, they like have to come and see it. They want to meet the store associates. And I do think that brick and mortar will be a part of the company's future, but given where the capital markets are, where everyone's so afraid right now, given everyone's closing their doors, everyone's afraid of physical retail, it's a lot harder than it was once to raise money for that, and I don't want to do that until I know we can really commit and not just have one more store, but have a plan to roll out. So I think we'll always be a digital native company that has the majority of our revenue coming through mobile. But I think the store is a place where you build the brand, build that relationship, and it definitely enhances LTV, and in the case of beauty, is a very profitable endeavor, for sure. It's been a great business.
Great. Okay, we have time for just one more question.
My question is, you started this company with a really good friend, and it sounds like you're still partners, and we talk about it, you smile. So tell me a little bit about that.
So, yes, I started this company with, you know, one of my best friends from school. We built it together kind of side by side operationally for 5 years, and then she decided it was time to do something else. She's now on the board, but still involved in, you know, different team members and what they're doing, and obviously very involved on the board. I'd say it's really impossible for me to imagine how anybody could do this without a partner, especially in the early days. It's really lonely, it's exhausting, and when you are kind of out in the world, you're just not there. And I feel like always I'd look across the room and see Haley, and like we'd both be at, you know, some sort of experience with our friends, but we were so preoccupied, and seeing her there would give me like, I don't know, it just helped me feel grounding. And we were also very complementary in having different things we were passionate about, different skills. Like, it was critical to everything that Birchbox is and will become, having like our very different approaches to everything. Like, we just saw things differently, but had a ton of respect for each other. So, I mean, it's really hard. People talk a lot about how hard it is to have a partner, but and from my perspective, again, when you get to build something that does find product market fit, that does really explode, I don't know how you could do it, because we could run at parallel, full speed, parallel, like, operating, keeping the trains running, you know, getting the new partners, getting the new ideas, getting things, you know, we could run, both of us, as fast as we could, trust each other, and knew that we both had so much passion for this. So it was absolutely critical.
Okay, so the final question I have for you is, first off, you jump-started the subscription box industry. You also disrupted the cosmetic and beauty industry, but you did it in a way that's creating many more winners than losers. Because usually when you hear disruption, there's negative implications. You've expanded it, so that's really a gift. So I'm just curious. I mean, those are two huge pillars in life already. What's actually next for you?
Personally?
Katia.
So, I mean, I'm a mom of twins. They're two. I'm very focused on trying to be a good mom, but I think I also feel very driven to change the world in any way that I can. And right now I have Birchbox, which has had the pleasure of touching hundreds of people's careers. And I do feel very focused on the idea that I want to build something that puts other people and leaders into the world that change the way, what it means to go to work every day in any industry, at any company. I feel very proud that everyone wants to recruit from Birchbox. I think it's amazing, and I want to change the way people think about leadership. I definitely think about being a woman, and that I want that to be more of a normal thing, to come home and tell your parents that your boss is great, and then say it's a woman, and that not be like weird. And I definitely think a lot about the responsibility to, you know, make sure that everybody has, as early in their career as possible, the opportunity to go for something big, like the expectation that you could do something big. And I know that there's a lot of, it is hard to employ a generation of millennials. I'm a millennial too, and I hear a lot of conversations around how hard it is, but I can't help but think, you know, when our recent graduates graduated from college, you know, the internet is this ubiquitous information, you know, experience. They've had so much more experiences than even I had, or that my mom had. Like, of course they have a different expectation for what they can contribute on the first day of their work. And it has been a privilege to experience that, right? Yeah. Because it's this young force of people that come out of the gate running, not just like with gusto and ambition, but with talent. And I want to be a part of helping shape that and turn that into such a positive thing, because I see it as such a positive that we have more and more people who are graduating that could really do things, add value from day one.
Yep.
So I think a lot about that.
Yeah, no, I'm actually blown away by this generation. Absolutely blown away by them, and have the fortune of seeing them because my kids are a little bit older than yours. And I think we have we collectively as
bright
a planner,
future.
We have a very bright future, yes. Katia, you are an inspiration, and thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you on behalf of everybody for the time today.
Thank you. Oh, my pleasure.